Welcome to SciTech Biosciences Full Spectrum Profiling Educational Series on Panel Design Best Practices. In this stepwise video series, we'll walk you through the guidelines on successful panel design and assay optimization. In this video, we'll talk about step one, marker expression and co-expression. Knowing the markers and their level of expression is a critical starting point for successful panel design. Let's get into the details. Panel design should be an informed process. You should start by following these three steps. First, you must determine the scientific question you want to answer, cell subsets that will be characterized, and the markers that are needed to define lineage and functionality. Second, you should gather additional detailed information, such as novel targets that should be added to the panel, preferred antibody clones, predicted antigen density, gating strategy, and available fluorochromes. Finally, you will apply this knowledge to understand and classify your antigens based on expression and co-expression. Let's begin with step one, using an example where you are studying natural killer cells, and your scientific question is, how are inhibitory and activation markers modulated in my experimental system? Since your population of interest is NK cells, it is important to know the lineage markers that define the population, such as CD56 in humans or NK1.1 in mice. The markers that define NK cell subsets, such as CD16. The exclusion markers to gate out unwanted cell types, such as CD14 for monocytes or CD19 for B cells. And finally, which markers are most critical to answer your scientific question. Next, we have step two, gathering information. A common question when designing a panel is, where can I access detailed information about my population of interest? Let's continue to use our NK cell panel as an example. Reagent vendor websites can help you find information about cell type-specific markers and fluorochrome availability. Here, we can see the page for Cytech's CD56 CFluor-R720 antibody. On these websites, there may also be details on antibody performance, recommended protocols, and publications that have used the given antibody. There are also open access databases that contain a wealth of useful information on biological markers, such as the Human Protein Atlas or Antibodypedia. Publications are another great resource. For our NK cell assay, we can examine this study by Montaldo and collaborators, as well as the CDMAPS publication by Thomas Kalina et al., which characterizes antigen expression levels for CD1 through 100. Optimized multicolor immunofluorescence panels, or OMIPs, are a collection of validated panels published in the journal Cytometry Part A. For example, OMIP 029 by Monkey et al. Describes the development of a 13-color assay to phenotype NK cells within human peripheral blood. Here, in Table 2 from this paper, we can view identifying markers, their fluorochrome selection, and which clones were tested. By further examining the OMIPS figures and detailed methods, we can find the gating strategy and expected antigen density. Finally, previous data generated in your lab can provide additional insight. For example, this experiment was generated by Cytech for NK cell characterization. We can use this data to gain information on the level of expression of our targets, confirm the gating strategy, and examine performance of reagents that have been tested. In this dataset, after gating out exclusion and viability markers, populations were narrowed down to CD16 positive, CD56 positive, NK and NKT cells. We further classified the cells by looking at the markers of interest. In contrast to our lineage markers, CD16 and CD56, our markers of interest like NKp80 and NKg2c can have varying levels of expression in different subsets. Now that we have our list of markers and understand their expression characteristics, we can proceed to step three, antigen classification. Antigens can be divided into three categories, primary, secondary, and tertiary. This approach to panel design was first described in the publication by Monkey and Roederer, which classifies markers based on their level of expression on target cells and their role in the assay. Primary markers have the highest antigen density. Expression is usually characterized as either on or off, and are used to identify main subsets, for example, CD56 on NK cells. Secondary markers have an intermediate or continuous density, and are often markers of differentiation or markers that allow us to further subset the cells of interest, for example, CD57 on NK subsets. And finally, tertiary markers are the most important for a given assay. These are the readouts, often with low or unknown density, or expressed in small subsets, such as NKp30 with low positivity. This publication goes on to emphasize that good panel design should balance antigen density and fluorochrome brightness. Bright fluorochromes should be paired with tertiary markers to achieve better resolution and reduce spillover. For primary markers, we do the opposite by assigning dim fluorochromes since they are already well separated. For secondary markers, we can assign what best fits the assay based on co-expression. Now that we understand the biology and the role that each marker plays in our NK cell subsets, we can make some assumptions regarding marker expression and co-expression for this panel. We first want to exclude several non-NK populations from our assay by using a dump channel for CD19, CD123, and CD14 negative cells. Though these are primary markers, they will not be expressed on any of our NK cells of interest. Similarly, we know NK cells will be CD3 and CD4 negative, so next we gate on that population. Now we can subset into potential target cells based on varying levels of our primary NK markers, CD56 and CD16. We can now refine our gating further to visualize the secondary and tertiary markers expressed in these populations. Knowing these expression patterns is essential because markers that are co-expressed will need to be assigned to fluorochromes with minimal spread, which we will learn about in the next video. So let's recap so far. The first step in panel design is to identify your scientific questions and populations of interest. Second, gather details, such as appropriate clones, antigen density, and gating strategy. And third, use this information to classify the antigens based on their expression and co-expression. This concludes step one of our panel design series. In step two, we will show you how to proceed with fluorochrome selection. Visit Cytech's SpectroLearn education page to learn more on this and many other topics.